this second part of the Farmington River Watershed Association's Aquatic Macroinvertebrate Presentation Series. This is Functional Feeding Groups and the River Continuum Concept. And my name is Heather Geist. I am the Education and Outreach Manager of FRWA. You can find out more information about our organization at frwa.org. This presentation is put on by the Connecticut Envirothon Aquatic Station YouTube channel. And let's go ahead and get started. As a little recap from last presentation, the aquatic macroinvertebrates live in the water. They're big enough for us to see with the naked eye without a microscope, and they are invertebrates, so they don't have a backbone, and many of them do have a hard exoskeleton. These macroinvertebrates are great water quality indicators because they live all of their lives in the water. They're very sensitive to pollution and changes in their environment. And they're really abundant. They're easy to catch and easy to find. So they can tell us a whole lot about what it's like to live in these certain rivers. So functional feeding groups is a concept that was developed in the 1970s. It's about the evolution of these bugs, these macroinvertebrates. They have very specialized feeding structures and feeding behaviors, which basically evolved because of what they eat, very similar to Darwin and his finches in the Galapagos Islands. So K.W. Cummins came up with four categories that he put these invertebrates into. We've got shredders, collectors, grazers or scrapers, and predators. So we'll start off by talking about the shredders. These guys have the specialized features of grasping legs and shredding mouth parts. They also, they use these parts to tear apart leaves, organic matter, things that fall into the river into much smaller pieces. So as you can see on these two examples here, the roach-like stonefly, Pelta perlidae, and the plant casemaker caddisfly, Lepidostoma, they've got ways that they can tear apart organic matter into smaller pieces that are easier to process. Some other examples of these guys are stoneflies, caddisflies, beetles, and true flies. They all have certain species that are shredders and have these kind of specialized mouth parts and tarsal claws. The next feeding group we have are collectors. These guys take the smaller particles that come downstream from the shredders and they can collect them with specialized gills, or legs that help move food towards them or catch it. And then some of them also can spin nets or create nets, like the net spinner caddisfly here, genus Hydropsychidae. We also have the brush-legged mayfly, Isonitia, which uses those brushy legs to capture particles to eat. Some other examples of collectors here. You can see a lot of collectors in caddisflies. You see them in mayflies, stoneflies, beetles, and the true fly families. So a lot of different kinds of insects do act as collectors. Our next feeding group are the grazers and the scrapers. They feed on algae and very fine pieces of matter that are on rocks and things on the bottom of the stream. These guys often have specialized features that help them cling onto the surfaces of rocks. And they usually have mouth parts that can chew up little pieces of particulate matter as well. Some examples of the grazers and scrapers are the water penning beetle, genus Cephanus, family Heptagenaeidae, which are the flat-headed mayflies, and the aquatic caterpillars, which are family Cramidae. Also in the grazers and scrapers, we see a lot of mayflies, stoneflies, caddisflies, beetles, true flies, and aquatic caterpillars, like that I mentioned before. Basically, any kind of macroinvertebrate family has at least a few species that have these kind of capabilities of scraping algae and debris off of rocks. Our final functional feeding group are the predators. We tend to know what predators do in ecosystems. They eat other insects generally and other kinds of animal tissue if they can get it. This guy, the family Corydalidae, fish flies and Dobson flies there on the left, he does bite humans. He'll take a tiny chunk out of you if you let them. These guys often have chewing mouth parts or piercing and sucking mouth parts. The dragonflies and damselflies have a lower mandibular labium that can actually come out and strike and pick prey up to pull it in towards them. That would be suborder Zygoptera, pardon me, and family Gomphidae that you see here on the screen. Other groups that contain species that are predators that you see here are going to be alderflies, dobsonflies, fishflies, stoneflies, dragonflies and damselflies, regular bugs, beetles, and the true flies. So there are a lot of different kinds of predators out there in the streams. Next, after learning about these functional feeding groups, is the river continuum concept. Van Noot et al. In 1980, Van Noot and Van Noot's peers realized that this certain composition tends to end up with these functional feeding groups as you go downstream in any river system. Aquatic macroinvertebrate communities will change in composition as one moves downstream away from the headwaters. So basically, you'll tend to see more of some guys up in the smaller river, smaller streams and brooks, pardon me, and it will be different as you move into a larger river. Upstream in the little areas, you're gonna see a lot of shredders and a lot of collectors. There's going to be a good amount of tree cover and shade, a lot of things falling into the stream from these trees that are broken down by the movement of water, rubbing up against rocks, and from these shredders that break down pieces into smaller ones where the collectors pick up those small pieces and further process them. As we move downstream in a system, we're going to see a lot more grazers than you would have seen upstream. We're going to see a wider channel width, so we're going to see a little bit more sunlight on the surface of the water, which means that algae can grow along the rocks that are on the bottom of the river here. So we're gonna see more grazers that can scrape these things off of the rocks and collectors that are getting fine particulate matter from upstream after the shredders have processed it. Once we get into a very large river, the channel is going to become wider and a lot deeper. So although sunlight is in the water column, it is not reaching the bottom of the river as much. So the main food source here is going to be very small bits of matter that are floating around in the water, either from being processed upstream or from phytoplankton, from floating algae in the water and periphyton. So here we're going to see a lot more collectors. We don't really see any shredders anymore because they're all upstream trying to get the bigger pieces of leaves. Predators, of course, they're in every one of these systems. If we can go back a little bit, I'll show you. They're also here. And they're here in the middle. They have a niche everywhere. So that's basically the entirety of the functional feeding groups in the river continuum concept in a nutshell. It's basically just evolution went a certain way that favored different characteristics in these bugs, and then they assorted themselves up and down throughout the stream in a way that worked for them. So if you guys want to meet these bugs again in person, you can go ahead and check out our website in September and August to see once we get volunteer opportunities up for our yearly macroinvertebrate sampling. We do it in September and October. It's a one-day field workshop. There is also an instructional webinar, which is done online these days. And this is part of the Connecticut Deeps Riffle Bioassessment by Volunteers program that we do. So keep an eye out if you want to get involved, and feel free to scan the QR code and find out more about what we do at FRWA. Thank you again for paying attention, listening to this. Here are some more resources that are fantastic about macroinvertebrates and stream ecosystems. Thank you very much and have a good day.